Vitamin D plays an important role in bone health, supports the absorption of calcium and phosphorus, helps reduce inflammation, supports the immune system, metabolism, and cell growth. This is why being deficient in vitamin D can lead to problems like bone pain, arthralgia, myalgia, muscle twitching, and weakness. In this video, I wanted to go over 7 things that you want to consider when taking vitamin D, so let's get started. Also, real quick before we start, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm and turn the bell on to stay up to date with new weekly videos. Now, I've already made a video on 10,000 IUs of vitamin D as well as vitamin D and hair loss that I encourage you to watch after this one. What many people forget actually is that vitamin D is actually a steroid hormone that interacts with our genes. There are vitamin D receptors located in almost every tissue in our body and in all the major organs as well. Thousands of vitamin D binding sites can be found throughout the genome, controlling hundreds and possibly thousands of genes. And according to some research, possibly involving 3-4% of the genome. And only about 50-90% is absorbed through the skin via sunlight. Very few people actually get enough vitamin D from their foods like eggs, liver, and oily fish. Plus, optimal absorption from food requires good fat digestion and healthy villi in the intestines of the gut, which many struggle with these days. So the sunlight is needed to produce it naturally. But here's the catch. The UV index needs to be 3 or more. In many countries, there's a limited window during the year to make vitamin D. Here's actually a map that shows insufficient UVB radiation throughout the year based off your location. It's crazy, sometimes as long as 6 months or longer for some places. And in terms of vitamin D deficiency, it's no surprise when you look at the map, you find about 41% of Americans deficient, 1 in 3 Australians deficient, and India being the most vitamin D deficient country in the world, making supplementation a real question to start asking. So that being said, the first thing that you want to consider before taking vitamin D supplements, the first is understanding who else is at risk of being deficient in the first place. So besides having low exposure to sunlight, there are about 7 other at-risk populations. 1, being 65 and older. 2, having obesity or have lost weight with bariatric surgery. 3, have osteoporosis or thin bones. 4, taking medicines like phenytoin and orlistat. 5, having problems absorbing nutrients. 6, having darker skin, and 7, breastfed infants. Now, I always recommend testing your vitamin D levels first using the 25-hydroxy vitamin D test, as it's the most accurate way to measure how much vitamin D is in your body. Many experts recommend at a level between 20 and 40 nanograms per milliliter. Others recommend a level between 30 and 50 nanograms per milliliter. These are the sweet spots to be in. The second thing that you want to consider before you take a supplement is knowing that vitamin D is fat soluble. There are 4 fat soluble vitamins, A, D, E, and K, which means the absorption of vitamin D is improved when you take it with fats. 11 grams of fat to be exact, as it was found better than 35 grams. And just an example of what 11 grams of fat looks like, it's 1/3 of an avocado, or about 2 teaspoons of olive oil, or roughly 2 tablespoons of flax seeds, and that should do the trick. The third thing that you want to consider before taking a supplement is if you're not fully at risk of developing a hypovitaminosis D or deficiency, and you live in a place where you're not confident that you're getting enough from the sun, especially if, let's say, you work from an office and are indoors all day, there are still a handful of foods that contain it. For example, 3 ounces of cooked rainbow trout provide about 645 IUs, and 3 ounces of sockeye salmon contain about 570. The only problem is that it may be more expensive to go this route versus a supplement. Also, fun fact is, the sun coming in from your windows, if you work at home or an office, are not giving you UVB, since UVB does not go through glass. So you won't be making vitamin D this way. The fourth thing to consider is there's actually an RDA for vitamin D. RDA stands for Recommended Dietary Allowance. It's set at 600 IU daily for adults up to 70 and 800 IU daily for people older than 71. Some of you might be thinking that is way too little, but it really depends on where your levels are at currently, right? If they're between 20 to 100 nanograms per milliliter, there's really no point to add higher than 600 IUs daily unless recommended by your doctor. The fifth thing to consider is taking too much vitamin D can lead to what's called hypervitaminosis D. As with most foods and supplements, more is not always better. It's a problem because it can lead to calcification of the soft tissue, and important to note is that it doesn't occur from sunlight or food, just supplements. So keep that in mind. The sixth thing is there are many forms of vitamin D. The two relevant ones to us are D2, ergocalciferol, and D3, cholecalciferol. But more specifically, D3, as it raises your D levels much higher than D2. There are other D vitamins too that are not commercially available and are still in the works, but they don't pertain to us just yet. And lastly, sunscreen will not cause a deficiency. I know a lot of people are not going to like hearing that for some reason, but the research shows us in 2019 called Sunscreen Photoprotection and Vitamin D Status that in fact, most studies published to date have shown no association between sunscreen use and vitamin D deficiency, even with regular use of SPF over 15. And this is coming from an international panel of 13 experts in endocrinology, dermatology, photobiology, epidemiology, and biological anthropology. This is probably because no one is getting every square inch of their body covered with it, or there's still a sufficient amount of UVB getting through without causing a sunburn, but still getting converted in the body. And now that you've gone through the seven factors to consider before supplementing, I've left below some of my favorite vitamin D supplements down below in case you wanted to pick any up. One with K2 and one without. I'll have a video on its use case with K2 soon, so definitely subscribe not to miss out on that one. In the meantime, click the video here to learn about vitamin D and hair loss, and let me know what your thoughts are down below. I'm more curious to actually hear from you guys. And until then, guys, I'll see you on the next one.